From trying to avoid punishment to protecting others from the truth, lying is a behavior we take part in frequently and for a clear purpose. With the average person lying 1 to 2 times per day, do we really understand the science behind lying? Today, my scientist friends and I will be breaking down the science of lying into 3 perspectives: biological, psychological, and sociological. First, let's try to understand why people lie in the first place. Is there a biological aspect to lying? To understand the biological side of lying, we must understand that humans are not the only animals that lie intentionally. This suggests an evolutionary purpose for lying. Humans are social creatures, and it is necessary for us to be accepted into our community for our success. Thus, lying allows us to participate in social groups and protect ourselves and others. It is also a natural human instinct to lie to protect offspring. Oxytocin is a hormone that's involved in both male and female behaviors. Specifically, it is involved in a response known as the tend and befriend, which balances tending to offspring and befriending social groups for mutual defense. Studies have shown that when administered oxytocin nasally, participants are more likely to lie compared to placebos. Since oxytocin is related to child bonding, it suggests that lying and oxytocin go hand in hand. Now let's discuss where lying lies in our brains. fMRI technology allows us to see blood flow activity in the brain. Studies using this technology have found that the anterior cingulate cortex and prefrontal cortex are mainly involved in deception. These areas are involved in high-level processing functions like impulse control, emotion, decision-making, and ethics. However, even with this information, it is difficult to pinpoint exactly where deception comes from. Nonetheless, we know it is not just a psychological thing. The biology of the brain does matter. For example, in conditions like Parkinson's, patients often have difficulty lying due to the pathological changes in their brain regions.
So previously, we've talked about the biological perspective of lying, and now we will be discussing the psychological perspective of lying.
From a cognitive perspective, lying takes up more energy than telling the truth. This is because lying involves creating a story instead of using a story from your memory. Liars also must be aware of what they say and make sure they do not contradict themselves or the person they are lying to. Liars have to keep the truth in their memory and ensure they don't say the truth when interacting with the person they are lying to. They also have to be aware of how they act and behave with the person they are lying to, as well as observe how that person behaves in order to prevent any acts of behavior being interpreted. Brain imaging research has shown that lying involves higher activity of specific regions in the brain than telling the truth. These specific regions involve the dorsolateral prefrontal and inferior frontal regions, which are active when performing complicated tasks. There are 3 potential functions that play a vital role in the increased cognitive effort of lying. One is working memory, keeping memory of the truth in order to create a successful lie, and this involves using energy to retrieve memories. And number 2 is response inhibition, prevention of revealing the truth, and it may involve inhibiting and activate a response that involves deception. Lastly, task switching. One may switch between the truth to the lie, which involves switching tasks. Based on research articles, it is found that there are 4 stages when lying: the activation of the truth from long-term memory, deciding and creating a way to alter information that is being shared, the construction of the lie, and the action of lying. Any of the 4 components can contribute to the cognitive cost of lying.
As we lie to deceive others for gain and self-interest, lying can be seen as a characteristic in some psychiatric disorders. Personality disorders such as antisocial, borderline, histrionic, and narcissistic, factitious disorder, and malingering disorder are a few to name. However, it is important to distinguish between lying and pathological lying when it comes to disorders. Pathological lying is lying without an obvious motivation, finding it almost difficult to control lying. As lying is goal-oriented, we can distinguish lying found within these disorders and pathological lying. If it is pathological, however, then it would be considered or seen as a coexisting disorder rather than a characteristic of an existing disorder. To illustrate, following someone who is addicted to psychoactive drugs or alcohol, one characteristic is lying or deceit either to themselves or others around them. According to Ford 1996 and Stroman Barone 1993, This behavior has many causes. Some of these include deception, to avoid shame over the fact that they are dependent, or to convince themselves and others that they have the ability to stop and recover after consumption. Therefore, although lying is a characteristic of addicted persons, this is not pathological, even if their behavior seems to depict so. Now, as we speak about pathological lying and lying, it is important to keep in mind that only a small portion of individuals are actually pathological liars, and this term should not be used as a synonym for excessive lying. It should instead be used for those who have a decreased ability to control lying for no reason.
As now we have gone through the different perspectives of lying, we hope you have a little bit more insight into the science of lying.